With Liszt more or less constantly on the road, Marie Dagoul had returned to Paris in the autumn of 1839 to face a difficult period of social rehabilitation. In accordance with the wishes of her family, her three illegitimate offspring were never mentioned and seldom seen even by their mother. The girls were entrusted to the care of Liszt's mother. The boy, Daniel, was left languishing in Italy for another 2 years before being fetched to join his sisters in 1841. To Mama Liszt's horror, he was delivered to her door quite literally starving. For his part, Marie's husband was prepared to forgive and forget, as it were, if she would consent to return to him. When she reported this to Liszt with the suggestion that she might take up the offer, he was appalled.
No, no, and no again. If your husband wishes to go to extremes, I shall come to Paris immediately and we will put a stop to it once and for all. Come what may, I am absolutely determined on it, and even you will not make me change my mind. Without doubt, in the eyes of the law, you belong to him body and soul. But matters do not always turn out like that in the world below. One temporizes, one arranges things. One agrees as one has to when each detests the other. Let us be confident as in the past. The hardest part is over, without doubt.
On the contrary, it had hardly begun. In addition to their fundamental incompatibility, and it should be noted here that Marie took not the slightest interest in Liszt's artistic life, their relationship was poisoned early on by Marie's chronic jealousy. The suggestion that she might return to her husband was no more than an attempt to fan the flames of Liszt's ardour by inciting that cancerous emotion in him. When that ploy failed, she tried again. In one extraordinary letter, she purported to seek Liszt's blessing for a little infidelity, as she plainly put it. His answer dumbfounded her.
You ask for permission to be unfaithful. Dear Marie, you know my way of looking at that kind of thing. I want and I wish you always to have complete freedom, because I am convinced that you would always use it nobly, tactfully.
He even invited her to talk freely to him about her prospective lover with no fear of reproach. Part of her problem was the simple fact that she got precious little chance to talk to Liszt about anything. He was hardly ever there. Her hopes that he would sooner or later return to Paris to resume their life together grew steadily more threadbare. With every passing year, more rumours reached her of his flagrant dalliance with other women. She became increasingly embittered. Like posterity after her, she chose to believe the rumours rather than Liszt's repeated disclaimers, let alone the evidence which supported him. The most celebrated of his fabled affairs was with the flamboyant, the notorious Spanish dancer Lola Montez, who went on to become the mistress of the King of Bavaria. Liszt's public association with this scarlet woman seems to have been the last straw for his abandoned countess, and it's not hard to see why. The very name of Lola Montez was a byword for scandal, which she clearly enjoyed to the hilt. The fact is, though, that her name wasn't Lola Montez, but Eliza Gilbert. She was not Spanish, but Irish. She was a dancer, a very poor one by all accounts, and there isn't a shred of evidence that she and Liszt were ever lovers. Anyway, it hardly mattered. Things between him and Marie had reached an all-time low, and in the spring of 1844 she proposed that from then onwards they should only communicate through a go-between. Liszt's response was brief, melancholy, and strange, hovering somewhere between apology and blame.
I am deeply sad and profoundly distressed. I count one by one all the sorrows I have put into your heart, and nothing and no one can save me from myself. I do not want to speak to you or to see you, even less to write to you.
But there was worse to come. Hardly for the first time in human history, love fermented into hatred, and Marie seems to have lost few opportunities to blacken Liszt's name. In 1845, news of her slanders reached him in Marseille. If he now wrote to her more in sorrow than in anger, it wasn't by much.
About a year ago, madame, I was able to think that the incredible opinion you hold of me, and expressed in several letters, remained a secret between us. I was even obliged to conclude from your past, full of ardent devotion to me, that you would keep the same reserve towards others as I had imposed on myself with regard to you. Now this illusion is no longer tenable, for I can no longer remain in ignorance of the fact that you are going about telling all comers the craziest and most foolish things about me. If it suited you to reflect for a minute, you would easily realize that it is absolutely impossible for anyone to discover the slightest foundation for the accusations that you make against me.
Nevertheless, the thought of his own children being turned against him by such accusations was more than Liszt could tolerate. It was now his turn for jealous fantasies. As things stood at present, he felt reasonably secure. Blondine was safely immured at a boarding school, away from her mother's clutches. Daniel and Cosima were in the care of Liszt's mother. But, as he wrote to Massard, the couple's unenviable go-between, he was tormented by the thought that Marie might try and take the children home with her by force. If that were to happen...
I should not consent to it, and would come to Paris to put an end to all these struggles some way or another. I would have no scruples either in taking all three of them away from her, without considering anyone or anything. The children simply cannot be raised at her home as long as we two are on the present terms with each other.
To both parents at this sorry point, the well-being of the children seems to have been a minor consideration. Liszt now went to considerable lengths to prove that in law the children were Hungarian. As they were also born abroad, and illegitimate into the bargain, their mother, under French and Hungarian law alike, had no parental rights whatsoever. Liszt was entitled, if he chose, to deny her all access to the children. One can hardly be surprised, then, that when Marie learned of this, relations between the erstwhile lovers reached an all-time low.
A year ago, sir, you said to me, "Be careful, you don't know what I'm capable of." Now I know. You are capable of trampling an honourable agreement underfoot, of imposing on a woman to whom you owe every respect, humiliating conditions when she wants to exercise her sacred rights, recognised by you. You are capable of the worst sort of cowardice, of threatening from a distance and on grounds of legality a mother who claims the fruit of her womb.
Never mind the fruit. Liszt's refusal to come to Paris, now that he knew he had the law on his side, only aggravated the matter. But Marie wasn't one to give up easily.
I admit, sir, that I have lost a desperate skirmish, in which I had nothing to invoke except your heart, your reason, and your conscience. But I protest before God and all mankind. I protest before every mother against the brutality that has been meted out to me. From now on, sir, your daughters no longer have a mother. That is what you wanted.
This understandably impassioned invoking of motherhood would be more moving if Marie had thought of it a little sooner. Her interest in the children up to this point had been minimal, to put it charitably, nor did either parent ever seem to put the children first. The effect on these hapless, semi-discarded progeny was predictably dire, but they managed somehow to preserve the illusion that they loved the parents they never saw, and that they were somehow loved by them, despite the lack of any convincing evidence. That illusion became harder than ever to maintain after an exchange of letters in 1850, sparked off by a touching and pathetic letter to Liszt from his first-born daughter, Blondine.
I write, my dear papa, to tell you how happy we are, and to tell you how we achieve this happiness which has been denied us for so long. We have seen mamma, and this great joy has made us forget the pain of our long separation. Each day I was feeling more and more grieved at not being able to see her, and was never happier than when I heard someone pronounce her name. During the holidays, someone mentioned her address in our presence. Next day we were completely preoccupied by what we had heard, and in the middle of our walk we had the sudden inspiration to go and see her, and that is how we met her again. We only stayed for a few moments with her. She was very moved and very surprised when she saw us. and she was especially happy to find that our feelings for her were as strong and as tender as ever.
The depth of Liszt's fatherly instincts may be gauged by his reply.
I have not only to scold you, but to blame you severely, for you have done wrong. You must know that if your grandmother did not take you to visit your mother, she was following my orders, and that in deceiving her you have deceived me. Precious as your affection is to me, I must tell you sincerely that I value it only in so far as you remain truly daughters after my own heart, whose upright will, sound reason, cultivated talents, lofty and steadfast characters are such as to bring honour to my name and ensure me some consolation in my old age.
Clearly this was not something he could rely on, so he turned, as ever, to the piano and wrote some consolations of his own.